Good morning. Good morning. Good, that's better. Welcome to Liberty Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here for our 8:30 time of worship. If you're a guest, we're especially glad that you're here today. You'll find a card that looks like this in the pew in front of you that says welcome. We'd love for you to take just a few moments to fill that out so we can have a record of your visit. We love getting these visitor cards and praying for people and just getting to know people in our area that are new to our church. And so please fill that out. You can put it in our offering plate as it comes by later or give it to one of our ushers at the end of the service. We do want you to feel welcome today. I want to tell you about a few things that are going on in the life of our church. First of all, our Awana recognition is tonight. If you want to, we would invite you to come back tonight for that. And so it's great just to see the young people, the kids, as we recognize them. And so please be back, come back tonight for our Awana recognition. Second thing is we want to also recognize, it's that time of year, where we want to recognize our graduates who are graduating from high school or college or graduate school. If you have a student or you know of someone who is a part of our church who is graduating, then please let us know. Call the office. That we want to give them a gift. And also, we want to recognize them. That will be on June 2nd that we'll recognize them in the morning services. So please, just let us know if someone that you know and love is graduating from either high school, college, or graduate school, and we will recognize them. Another thing is our marriage vow renewal and reception. You heard a little bit about this last week, but I'll tell you a little bit more. This is, we're calling it Save the Date. This is for any couples who are married and want to renew their vows. It's going to be, let's see, there's a Sunday school, there are rolls, sign-up sheets in the Sunday school rolls, and you can also sign up in the church office. The deadline is May 28th. Child care is provided. You can contact John Caldwell or Shana Canada if you have any questions about that. Third thing I'll mention is our children's choir program. I've seen them practicing this. It looks like it's going to be really, really nice, really good. And so it's called Simon Says Jesus is the Son of God. So please come on out. That's on June 2nd as well. So in the morning, we'll recognize our graduates, and in the evening, we will have our children's play. So that will be that's going to be a really good day. I might just like skip until June 2nd. It's going to be really awesome. Anyways, that's at 7 o'clock, so please mark your calendars for that, and we'd love to see you out for our children's choir play. Next thing I'll mention is our Athens VBS, so please be a part of that. We have volunteers who are coming in and saying that what they want to be a part of that. If you would like to volunteer, there is always going to be a place for you. There's always something for a volunteer to do around here, especially at VBS time. I know that from experience. Even if you feel like you have no talent, we have something for you to do, okay? There's no requirement. All right. That's June 24th through 28th. If you are interested in that, there will be a meeting June 4th for all of our workers as well. Last thing I'll mention is our car show. That is for our youth, and we are excited about this event. If you know somebody or you yourself have a car that you'd like to show off, then we would love for you to be a part of that. Or if you just want to come on out, there's going to be something for everybody. We're going to have things for the kids to do. There's going to be something for the adults to look at. And so we're just excited about our car show. We'd love to see you out for that. It's June 15th out at Cedar Line Automotive. Well, a lot of things to be excited about this morning. Why don't we stand and greet one another as we begin our time?
This morning to praise the name of Jesus. God, we can't help to think about all the folks who are struggling today, from physical problems to people who are struggling with issues that are not physical. And so, God, we just lift them up. God, it just seems that our prayer list is always full of needs. So, God, we try to be faithful to lift each and every one up before you. And so, Heavenly Father, we just pray that you would bear with the body, that you would minister your grace to people. God, I even think this week about the Rohde family, who several sons had to bury their mother. And God, we just pray that you would minister to them in a special way even today. And God, as we turn our attention to your word today, and we look afresh at the Gospels, and we just simply ask, what does it mean to be a disciple? God, may you challenge my thinking and our thinking. And God, may we hear those words afresh to follow you. And God, may we do it with more obedience. And God, may we become like you. And God, may we engage this process in a more vibrant way today. May today be a fresh beginning for many of us as we once again embark on the journey to follow you. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
I live the life. is the Lamb that was slain. For he is the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. In him alone is our hope found. Let's stand as we sing about the hope that we have in Christ alone.
Father, we really thank you for all the many blessings you've given us, Lord. We thank you for the rain, Lord, that's reviving our creation here. And Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you've given us, and we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would rain down on us and in our lives. And as we come through this time of the service, we pray, Lord, that you would give us a widow mite's heart in the giving of our tithes and offerings, and that you would bless it and use it for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
I think if we're honest with ourselves, we'd all admit that we have a confidence problem. And I'm not talking about self-confidence. I'm talking about a confidence in God problem. And the truth is, we have every reason to be confident in God. Every logical reason. And we just need to tell ourselves the truth. Some of these truths are that God is completely sovereign. He knows. He hems you in before and behind, the psalmist David said in Psalm 137. He knows the future as well as he knows the past. He knows the plans that he has for you. He has good plans. He works all things together for good to those who love God. That's the truth. You can tell yourself that. Truth is, God is incredibly powerful. I remember growing up, and my dad would read from the old King James, and he would talk about the Lord of hosts. And I wasn't really sure what that meant, but the more I looked into it, how exciting it is. The God of angel armies, the God of immense power. His Holy Spirit lives in you. You have every reason to be confident in God. And the third reason that I can just think of off the top of my head is the most exciting of all is we're confident because we have a heavenly hope. We have a wonderful hope. We have a glorified body to look forward to. We can live in the presence of God. We have all these wonderful promises and every reason to be confident in God. And I hope this song will help you do that.
Darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? Crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, no troubles linger still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will tell everything, yours is the victory. Who shall not fear? Who shall not fear? I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Nothing for and against me shall stand. Always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Forever. by my side.
Well, today we begin a new sermon series simply entitled Following Jesus, subtitled Embracing Our Discipleship Journey with Jesus. I certainly hope you visualize your Christian life in many ways, but one of the ways that I think is the most simple way to visualize our Christian life is to simply be following Jesus. This is the most basic of images that we could, that would come to our minds, a band of disciples following, learning, seeing Jesus, and trying to live like He did. This sermon series was really born in my heart when I began to ponder some very simple and basic questions of the faith. Here are some of the basic questions. What does it mean to live the Christian life? If I were to ask you this question and ask you these questions in random fire, how would you answer them? What does it mean to live the Christian life? You've got one sentence to answer that question. What does it require of me to truly become like Jesus? You've got one sentence to answer that question. Does my life resemble something that would please Jesus? You've got one word to answer that question, yes or no. And what does it mean to be Jesus' disciples? As I began to ponder afresh some of these basic questions, I fear that I had too quickly or too simply answered these questions. I mean, the most basic question of Christianity has to be this: what does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus? That's a basic question. What does it mean? I mean, we come here, we gather underneath the stained glass windows, we sit in the pews, and we say we're followers of Jesus, but what does it mean? Just basically, what does it mean to be a follower or a disciple of Jesus? If I were to ask you that, there's multiple answers to that very question in this room. There are probably at least five different answers that I would get. There are probably five different answers if you went to your local Christian bookstore and bought books on discipleship. You get these various responses. Some people would say, well, what is a disciple? A disciple's a learner. Some people would say, well, disciples are a little bit different because they're committed believers in contrast to the uncommitted believers. Some would say, no, disciples aren't primarily learners. Their disciples are primarily doers. They're ministers. Some people would say, well, disciples are converts, but then discipleship comes later. People would say this. Some people would say that disciples are converts who are in the process of discipleship. And so as I began to collect all these various definitions of discipleship, I said, I really need some help. I really need some clarification. I really need to cut through all of this to see what's at its core. And so this compelled me to address the question, a basic question: did Jesus Himself have a process and a goal for discipleship? And so as I looked at the Gospels afresh, I came to find out that clearly Jesus had a discernible method and He had a discernible goal for His disciples. You know, this is probably the most profound thing I'm going to say through this series, is Jesus did not just have a message to share, He had a method by means of sharing it. And Jesus did not just call for converts, people to say, yes, I believe in Him. Jesus called for disciples, people that would trust in Him and then follow Him the rest of the way. You know, the goal of discipleship, you ready for it? You know what the goal of discipleship is? The goal of discipleship is, I'm going to give you a Bible word and then I'm going to explain it. The goal of discipleship is apostleship. Now, apostles were an office, but apostleship is also a vocation. The word apostle means to be sent. Why did Jesus train the early band of men? He knew He was going to leave, and they were going to have to take up His task. And so discipleship
is really a process that has a goal. A disciple is not to be a learner forever. A disciple is to move from disciple to apostleship. He's to move to the place where he looks like Jesus, acts like Jesus, and is not the one trained, but is the one that is doing the training. See, the discipled should become in time the discipler. The one taught the things of God in time should turn into the teacher. The one who receives the ministry of Christ should be the one in time who gives the ministry of Christ. The one who hears the gospel message initially should be the one who shares the gospel message. The discipleship has a goal, and I think as we open our eyes to the gospels afresh, we're going to see that not only did Jesus have a message, but he had a method, and he carried it out with great consistency. Now, discipleship's a lifelong process, isn't it? We move from being that person who's acquainted with Jesus to the person who looks like Jesus and serves like Jesus, but even though it's a lifelong process, it doesn't mean that we have to go so slow through the process, right? There is movement that should be happening, and it does take time for this movement to take place, but progress should be made. And you say, Rusty, how do I know if I'm making progress in discipleship? Well, see if you're going from the one taught, the one being served, the one shared to the person who's doing the teaching, doing the serving, doing the discipling. Because it would be Simon Peter who Jesus will meet, who's just a rough old fisherman. Simon Peter, by the time he's gone through Jesus' program, he's going to be the great apostle of the church. You're going to meet a lot of these ragtag men who Jesus meets, but by the time Jesus is done with them, they're the great religious teachers that are heralded in the church. You see, there's the process, isn't it? You see them where they start out, and you see them where they end, and you see that the process has been worked, and a person has been made, and a disciple has been formed. This is the process that Jesus wants us to embrace. And so not only do I want us to focus through this series on the message of the gospel, I want us to focus on the method that Jesus lays out before us for the process of discipleship. Now, I do have one simple objective, and we're going to be a little bit interactive right here today. One of my simple objectives through this series is for you to memorize our church's mission statement. Now, I know this is called the Proclaimer. We lay it around church every Sunday, and since I've been the preaching pastor, this statement has always been right on the front of the Proclaimer. So I tell you, what we're going to do is we are going to read this aloud together, because I've asked a few people, do you know what our church's mission statement is? We got a mission statement. Okay, well, that's not good. It's been on the front of the Proclaimer since for 5 years, every Sunday. So let's read it aloud. You ready? There it is on the screen. 1, 2, 3. Working together to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the glory of God. There it is. There's our mission statement. Now, we didn't come up with this out of thin air. We came up with this because this is really at the heart of Christianity. Now, I want us to, not only do I want you to memorize the mission statement, I want you to be able to explain the mission statement. All right? So if somebody asks you, what's kind of the purpose of Liberty? You say, well, we work together to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the glory of God. Now, it's not just enough to memorize the sentence. I would also like you to be able to explain the sentence. Some people have said, Rusty, it's too long. Well, we've tried to shorten it. I've tried to shorten it. But it's only a sentence. I mean, one sentence. You can memorize that, right? It's only one sentence. And really, every word has a distinct emphasis. So let me just explain our mission statement to you. The word working is important. I didn't say learning together, although I could have. I didn't say feeling together, although I could have. I said working. And the reason is because Christianity learned and Christianity felt is ultimately Christianity displayed. And so it's action. One of the things that makes Jesus' discipleship different from the disciples or the other teachers of his day is that Jesus' teaching required action. He wasn't like a Plato who was right before Jesus who said, just learn all of these abstract truths. No, Jesus says, you learn these truths to do something with them. And so the first word in our mission statement is important, working. It means that we're going to take what we learn and take what we feel and we're going to put it into something that is real and practical and tangible. So it requires action. And then the word together. I really like this word because discipleship is really not it is done by the individual. It's the individual's responsible for it, but discipleship has to occur in a group. Even Jesus did his discipleship with 12 men. It was in a group context. And we don't have all that we need as individuals to accomplish our own discipleship. We need the body to round us out. And so the word together is important. We have movement, we have action, but we do it together. Now, this is always a struggle for a group of people, right? Because it's like you get a group of pastors in a room. You get five pastors in a room, you get six opinions. It's that type of thing. I mean, it's a struggle, but we've got to do this together. We've got to move through the process together, working together. Is the first part. And then the idea to make disciples, that's what we're going to focus on throughout this series. Notice something that I didn't say. We could have said working together to make converts. And I'm afraid that's been the Baptist mission statement for a while. Working together to make converts. Nothing wrong with, praise God, for people to trust in Jesus. But Jesus did not say go into all the world and make converts. He did not say that. Jesus says, go into all the world and make disciples. And may I say, there's a big difference between a convert and a disciple. Because part of being a disciple is that we have the responsibility not just to share the message with them, but to teach them everything Jesus has commanded us. That is a much more rigorous process. And it's really a shame to me that in the church we've separated evangelism and discipleship when Jesus would be appalled at the separation. Jesus says, you call people to me so that they trust in me and then continue on the journey of discipleship. And so while we are ecstatic if people come to faith, and we call people to faith, and we call people to conversion, our mission statement is not just to call people to conversion. Our mission statement is to make disciples of them. And a disciple-less Christianity is something that Jesus would not recognize. Is something that he would not even know what to do with. And so it's something that requires action, that it's unified. We're doing it in the context of the church. It's not just conversion, it's discipleship. It's believing in Jesus and then becoming like Jesus and then serving like Jesus. And then we do all of this not for personal glory. By the way, I've seen men and women who call a lot of people to faith and get a lot of conversions, and I always wonder, is it for their glory or for God's glory? I mean, I've met a lot of Baptist ministers. I've saved 14 people this week. No, you haven't. You haven't saved anybody. Might have shared the message and God might have shown up. It's for God's glory that we do this stuff. It's for God's glory that we engage in this process. And so I just have a simple objective for you. Throughout this series, we're going to memorize the mission statement. We're going to be able to explain the mission statement, and then we're going to be able to do this. We're going to be able to think afresh about how did Jesus make disciples. If you have your Bibles today, we're going to start in the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, verses 29 through 42, where we will see how those early disciples began their journey with Jesus. They were drawn to Jesus. And in essence, this is where the discipleship journey begins. It really begins in a very simple place. Step one in the method of discipleship. Here it is. You ready? Step one in the method. To be a disciple, you must first be introduced to Jesus. Isn't that so basic? But the truth is, many people are disciples of a thousand things. But to be a disciple of Jesus, you've got to be introduced to Him. You got to know who he is. A new teacher's in town, and you've got to follow in his way. The first point today, to be a disciple, we must listen to what other Christians say about Jesus. By the way, the way the world comes to know about Jesus is guess what God ordained means for the world to be introduced to Jesus is by who? By who? By us, by the Christians. And we get to see John the Baptist, the forerunner, already fulfilling that role. John chapter 1, verse 29 says, "The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And this is the one I told you about. After me comes a man who has surpassed me because he existed before me. I didn't know him, but I came baptizing with water so that he might be revealed to Israel.'" Now, the ministry of Jesus really comes at the conclusion of another ministry. John the Baptist has been given the job to be a forerunner of Jesus. John the Baptist, this wild old apostle, has been living out in the desert. I mean, John the Baptist would be an interesting character, to say the least. I mean, he's a wild man. He really is. I mean, he's living out in the desert. He's dressed up in camel hair. He's eating locusts and wild honey. I mean, have you seen the cicadas around? Would you put that thing in your mouth? I mean, my goodness. But it's the diet of desolation. The only reason you eat those cicada things is because you're really hungry, right? You're really starving to death. And John the Baptist is out in the wilderness like an Old Testament prophet, and he's eating the diet of desolation, and he is decrying that the kingdom of God is right upon us. And so people are hearing John the Baptist, and really they're flocking out to the wilderness to see the wild man. And John the Baptist has one simple message. You better get your hearts ready, because King Jesus is about to appear. That's his simple message. His message is so simple. He's just saying, repent. Repent means to get right, to realize your sinfulness. And John not only has a message, he has a method. The method of preparation for John was to draw a big crowd out in the wilderness and to baptize people for the purpose of them identifying that they are sinful people. That's John's method. John's baptism, by the way, is not Christian baptism. John's not baptizing people in the name of Jesus. John's baptism is he's baptizing people, and people are saying that they are sinners, and so they're being prepared. And in one day in the midst of John carrying out his ministry, Jesus walks right along the shore, and John the Baptist sees him, and John the Baptist probably throws that hairy finger of his in the air and says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." At that moment, John the Baptist is signaling that his ministry is ending and Jesus' ministry is just starting. Now notice how John introduces the world to Jesus. This was John's job. John could have said anything, and yet he came up with a title for Jesus. John says, "Behold the Lamb of God, the sacrificial lamb." Not the great conqueror, not the revolutionary, not the religious teacher. He says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." John, at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, is highlighting the culmination of Jesus' ministry, which is his death in the place of other people. And these people who have been prepared by John now see the real solution to their sin problem will be none other than Jesus himself. And then John says, this isn't just a religious teacher, by the way. He says, "After me comes a man who has surpassed me because he existed before me." Now, that's not true chronological age. John the Baptist is actually older than Jesus chronologically by age. And John the Baptist is making a more profound point that Jesus is man, but he is also God in the flesh. Here is God in the flesh coming not as a revolutionary, not as a conqueror, but as a sacrificial lamb who will stand in the place of the people. John's given an awesome role, and that is pointing other people to Jesus. May I say something? I don't know where you are today, but it is our responsibility as Christians to tell you, if you're here today and you're not a Christian, that God has come in the flesh to live on the earth, to die on the cross in your place. Your sin problem you cannot solve on your own. And thus God in His infinite love has sent Jesus to come and die in your place so that you can have a restored relationship with Jesus. If you're here today and you're not a Christian, today you can take that first step, that absolutely necessary step of becoming a disciple, and that is understanding who Jesus is. He's a lot of things. He's a teacher. In many ways, He was a revolutionary. But John decides that the way He needs to be introduced to the world is the one who takes our sin away. This week I was running, or trying to run. I did a lot of walking. But you know, it's all about the effort, isn't it? And I've often seen that the point of me running is oftentimes me not running. I just get out and about. How many times have I just been out in the community and this happened? I was running. I was about to the J. Jamerson building, and a boy that I knew, he's now 20. I knew him when I was youth pastor in Concord. He came running up next to me, and I knew his. I'd shared the gospel with him several times before, and I just began to talk to him about his spiritual life. I could tell that he probably wasn't living for the Lord. Is he going to church anywhere? No, not really. He said, I do come to those events you have at Liberty. I said, well, that's good, but, you know, finish the job. Make it all the way into the church building, you know. I said, you got to make it all the way around. He said, you know, I might think about that. He says, you remember when you used to play basketball with us in Concord? I said, yeah. He said, you guys almost killed me. He said, you know, I remember, he said, you weren't the best basketball player, you're just big. And I said, well, that's fine, you know, you've got to use what you got, you know. And he says, I know you go out there, and he says, we try to kill you. I said, I know. I said, I'd be licking my wounds Monday morning, or Thursday morning after Wednesday night. He said, but you remember how after we play basketball, you sit all those guys down and you try to share the gospel with them for about 5 minutes? I said, yeah, I really remember doing that. He says, you know, one of those buddies of mine that came with me there, he says, you know, we used to talk about what you said. I said, really? He said, you know, me and that buddy were together the other night, and I couldn't figure out exactly what he said. Either that buddy was shot at or shot. He says, you know, I sure am glad you talked to him about God. You know, you know, we have that responsibility, don't we? Because what did that guy know? He knew that his buddy could have been gone, right? His buddy could have been gone. He's running with the wrong crowd. He says, you know, I remember that 5 minutes after you get beat up playing basketball, I remember you sharing with us about Jesus. He says, I really am glad you did that. You know, I wondered after this week, you know, this is the most basic truth that we have as Christians. That is, we've got to be the ones who point people to Jesus. We've got to tell them. By the way, people don't know who Jesus is. You might think they do, but they're just so full of questions. If you just know that Jesus is God who's come in the flesh to die on the cross to take away your sins, you have just told some people a lot of stuff they don't know. Because, you know, you ask the average person, what does it take to go to heaven? What do they say? Be a good person? That's not at all the gospel message. They don't know. I mean, we've got to stop assuming, as Christ's disciples, if we are, that other people know about Him. You know, I'll tell you something. We worked really hard here. I worked really hard here at trying to just make the church more attractive place for people. You know, we throw events. We have activities. But you know what? It ain't about making the church attractive to people. It's about making Jesus recognizable to people. It's about getting them together like John did and then say, all of this stuff we do is nice. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We're not here to glorify ourselves or to attract a crowd. We are here for the purpose of gathering people to tell them who Jesus is. And I'm just going to say for my sake, this week, I've just said, Rusty, you're going to share. I got in the truck. By the way, I was running again. And it started raining like crazy. And then a guy picked me up, you know, off the side of the road. Because he said, you want to ride? I said, absolutely. But I had an ulterior motive. I knew the guy wasn't in church. And I got in the truck, and in 5 minutes, I changed the conversation. I said, where are you with the Lord? He said, what do you mean? I said, listen. You've been ministering to people before. What are you doing now? Oh, I do something every now and then. I said, Jesus doesn't want something every now and then. He wants something all the time. I said, come on. He said, you know, I probably ought to start picking up the pace. I said, absolutely. I said, we don't have time for discouragement. We don't have time for this. The world's dying. I said, you got to get up and start pointing people to Jesus. So he let me out of my house and drove on back to his house. But I just decided this week, listen, I'm going to start doing this. Stop making excuses for myself. When I get in conversation with people, I'm not going to assume that they're okay spiritually. I'm going to say, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. I'm going to start playing this role. It is so key to being a disciple of Jesus. You say, man, Rusty, I'm scared to death to share the gospel message. Well, the second point today, to be a disciple of Jesus, we must experience the divine confirmation about Jesus. The good thing is we don't just have a message that has intellectual properties. We have a message of supernatural origin. This is a big deal. This message is not something that's just like, oh, well, that's nice. Jesus is a great teacher. Look what happened when John points to Jesus and Jesus comes to be baptized. John 1:32 says, and John testified, I watched the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he rested on him, and I didn't know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water told me, the one you see with the Spirit descending and resting on, he is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that he is the Son of God. Again, the next day, John was standing with two of his disciples. Now, John the Baptist got the awesome privilege of baptizing Jesus. But we hear in the Gospels that when John baptized Jesus, something supernatural happened. You have really I know the Trinity is hard for people to understand, but right here at the baptism, you've got all the players involved. You've got Jesus, who is God, being baptized. You got the Holy Spirit descending like a dove on Jesus. And then you've got God the Father who's shouting from heaven, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Now I bet you John, after sharing the message, got some real confirmation here, didn't he? The old wild man John, who's been out in the desert, who's been pointing people to Jesus, and Jesus finally comes. He says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John takes Jesus, baptizes him, and as soon as it does, divine confirmation hits. And may I say to you, John the Baptist's message was confirmed by God. You know, I think as disciples, as we go out to introduce other people to Jesus, we've got to trust God to confirm his message. We've got to trust God with it. You say, well, Rusty, I don't know how people are going to respond if I begin to be his disciple and point people to Jesus. We've got to trust God to confirm the message. This isn't just a message that you have to convince people to believe, by the way. This is a message that you share and you let God convince them to believe. This is a different order altogether. You know, the confirmation of the gospel does not primarily come through intellectual argumentation or emotional feelings. I believe that God deals with us in a deeper way. He just whispers to our heart that this is true. And so I'm just asking you today if we are going to become a disciple. By the way, you may be here today and you've never trusted in Jesus. And I'll just share with you that Jesus is the one who's come to take your sins away. And you say, Rusty, that's so foreign. That's so out of my context. But you say, Rusty, in the same moment, I feel that something deep in my heart is telling me that's true. That's God confirming His message. This is the way it works. This is the way it operates. And so if you're here today and you've heard the message and you feel God confirming the message in your heart, that is none other than Jesus Himself pulling you, saying, come and follow me. Come and trust in me. And as Christians, we have the responsibility to do as John did and point people to Jesus. The third and final point today is to be a disciple of Jesus, we must personally believe in Jesus. Look at Jesus as He gathers this first group of apostles, it says, our first group of disciples. It says, when he saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. Evidently, John just kept doing this. He just couldn't stop. Every time Jesus walked by, look, the Lamb of God. And it was like, we got it, John. And then John, well, look, the Lamb of God. I mean, it's like, everybody's like, we got it, John. Somebody else, well, look, the Lamb of God. Well, isn't that a great example for us? Isn't that our role? Every time Jesus brought up, we just bring him up again. People didn't know. They knew what John thought about the situation. Verse 37, the two disciples heard him say this and followed Jesus. John pointed, and guess what starts happening? People start following. And when Jesus turned and noticed them following, he asked them, what are you looking for? And they said to him, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Jesus says, come and you'll see. He replied, so they went and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day. And it was about 10 in the morning. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard John and followed him. The first found his own brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah, which means anointed one. And he brought Simon to Jesus. And when Simon saw him, he said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which means rock. John points, God confirms, people follow. See how that works? John points, God confirms, people follow. This is how discipleship starts. You hear, you are introduced to Jesus, God confirms His message in your heart, you follow. As disciples, we point people to Jesus, God confirms, they follow. Pretty simple, isn't it? Pretty simple introduction. But there it is laid out in the Gospels. So if you're here today and you're not a Christian, here's your moment. Today you can begin your discipleship journey. Today you can say, I'm going to start following Jesus. The message was shared, the confirmation came, and these early men gathered around Jesus to talk with him, to live with him, and it didn't take them too long. They said, you're actually that guy. You're the Messiah. And Jesus says, now you've taken the first step. This is how the discipleship journey begins for all of us. And so if you're here today and you're not a Christian, today's the day. Why not start your discipleship journey today? Why not trust in Jesus and be a disciple? Today's the day. Trust in Jesus. And if you are a Christian today, remember we move from discipleship to apostleship. John the Baptist was already playing his role. He shared, he pointed to Jesus, the message was confirmed, people followed. And if we are a disciple, we ought to also be involved in moving towards doing these type of things. And so my simple question to you today is, are you a disciple of Jesus? Have you ever trusted in Jesus? If you haven't, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world wants to take away your sin today. This is the first step. You must trust in Jesus. So if you're here today and you're not a Christian, I'll be right down here at the front. And if you are a Christian today, let's think about this. If we have truly found God in the flesh who has taken away our sins and shown us how to live, why wouldn't we be motivated to follow whatever He says? I mean, if you really believe that, you believe you found God in the flesh who takes away your sins, who's shown us how to live, no matter where he leads, you'll follow, won't you? I mean, if you're being rational, you're being logical. And so I would ask those of you who are Christians today, say, God, wherever you lead me through this series, I'm going to follow. If it's through the Garden of Gethsemane, I'll be there. If it's on the mountaintop, I'll be there as well. Wherever you go, I'll go. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that our discipleship journey begins by us seeing you for who you are. And God, I just pray today that if there's a person in this room who doesn't know you, that today they would begin that journey. Today they would trust in you. Today they would believe in you. In these moments of decision, that they would get out from the seat where they are, walk this aisle, and say, today I trust in Jesus. God, as we study on discipleship, may someone begin that journey today. May they make that step of faith today. God, those of us who are Christians, God, may we multiply your kingdom through pointing other people to Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together.
I believe he is the Son of God. I believe he died and rose again. I believe he paid for us all. I believe he's here now. He's standing in our midst.
Confirmation of the decision today. Everyone in this room has said that they have trusted in you, because no one has come to respond to the gospel message. And so, God, I thank you
The people in this room today, by their testimony, have said that they are your disciples. And so now, Heavenly Father, as we leave from this place, as your disciples, may we find those who have not trusted in you. God, may we not point them to a church or to ourselves, but God, may we point them to you. God, may we be obedient to this. God, may we trust you to confirm your message. God, we pray that you would break their hearts and that they would believe in you. In Jesus' name, amen.